Oh, they did everything. They did everything. They cleaned and laundry, cooking, everything. In fact, he'd even buy the groceries and stuff like that. So, yeah, they did everything.
Okay.
I wish I had him now.
Okay. Describe the area around the house in terms of what who owned some of the other farms around you.
Oh, I don't know. You'd have to ask Jim that. Because in those days, farmers were very much themselves. There was one family that lived on the east side of the road. And their name was Anderson. And as I remember, I think they were Danish. And they stuck to themselves. You know, they were friends with other... And then the sheep people that were on the north side of us, their name was Thud, and they were Danish. And they sort of stuck together. And they were very... in those days, they weren't very social. They really... And the man that had the dairy on farm on the west side of us, I never did know his name. I don't even know him. I don't think I ever saw him even.
Mm-hmm.
People were very, they were used to being by themselves and self-sufficient, and they stayed that way. And they were mostly foreign-born like that. They grew up that way. And it was interesting. And then there were others, like... what was her name? They're taking me back a long ways with people that I haven't seen for 100 years. But there were some families out there that had been there for years and were... I can't remember, but there was a family that... Oh, Dobsons, the Dobsons. How could I forget that? They have a street named after them. And that was always Dobson Road. Always, because they lived up there near Baseline was their all their land, and they were big, and they had, and they'd been there for years and years and years. When my mother taught school, their father had the bank in Chandler, so they were old time settlers. Mm. So, but they were friendlier, and we would socialize with them, and then people like that. But the ones around us were very independent and very, but yet I think if we'd have needed them for anything, they'd have been there. That wasn't that. It was just that they kept to themselves, mm-hmm. and they didn't live the way we did, and so they were just. It was so I really didn't ever meet any of them very. I think maybe just met them was all, but that was it.
So more of the social life was more of the friends in Phoenix and
well, and the small circle of friends in Chandler too. Mm-hmm. We spent a lot of time with them.
Maybe you can talk about who some of your friends were, both from Chandler and then from Phoenix, some of the families.
Well, friends.
Yep. Here we go.
Okay.
Well, in Chandler, the Bogles lived there, Jack and Barbie Bogle. And my husband had grown up with the Bogles family. They all came from New Mexico. And Jack has a brother that's the same age as Jim, and his name is Jim also. And so they'd known each other since they were children. Their parents had been friends, and their fathers had been friends before they were married. Either one of them, so it went way back. So when we came to Chandler, Jack and Barbie took us under their wing and introduced us to their friends. And that's the way we became acquainted, and that's why we had such good, close friends in Chandler. Well, Jim and I were talking about that, and now the only ones left are Jack and Barbie and Elizabeth Neat. and everybody else has passed away. And they were a little older than we were, just enough for it to show up now. But so the names wouldn't mean anything to you, and they're not there anymore. Mm-hmm. But in Phoenix, my husband had gone to school in Phoenix, some grammar school and some high school, and so he had longtime friends there, and there just aren't too many names right now that are still here. I mean, lots of our friends are still here, but the names are not as well known as they were in those days, because Phoenix has grown so much, and mm-hmm. the parents have died, and some of our friends have died too. And there's still Bob Goldwater, but his sister died, and his brother, and it's come down to I know another name is the Diamonds, that had Diamonds department store that Dillard's bought, and they're longtime Phoenix people, and they're friends, Ralph Diamond and his wife, and she grew up in Phoenix too, but her name isn't important anymore, and it's just old timers. Mm-hmm. It really is we know.
Tell me some of the family, even if they're not around anymore or whatever. I'm still curious to know who some of them were.
Some of the names.
Yeah.
Well, like the Norps. He had the newspaper many years ago, Wes Norp, and they had a daughter that was Jim's age. Jim grew up, and she just died this last year, and you stop for remembering the old names, and so I just can't think right offhand of too many of them. Oh, well, A.L. Moore and Sons. Well, Al Moore is one of the sons, and he's a friend of ours. And then he has a cousin, Tom, who's the two brothers. Their fathers own the mortuary together. And Tom is a friend of ours, and my husband grew up with him. And they're still here. And so many of these businesses don't have the name anymore. They've been sold to other people, or corporations have bought them. But right offhand, those are about the only names I can come up with
mm-hmm.
that are still, people still know. But
what about in Chandler? You mentioned the Bogle family and Elizabeth Neat, but who are some of the other families?
Now, what was that?
Who are some of the other families that you associated with in Chandler?
Well, like I say, they're not left.
Mm-hmm.
There just aren't any left.
Okay. Were there any stores or small businesses in the area at all?
Well, yes, there was a Dudding's drugstore, and that's the only drugstore, I think, and everybody did their druggist business there. And then there was Bash's, of course. And let's see. Oh, there was Stapley's. They had a hardware store, and that's an old Mormon family that from Mesa, and they had one of their sons had that store. And that's about all I can think of. There wasn't much mm-hmm. there then.
Okay.
And then the hotel, San Marcos.
Were there any little corner markets or anything that were nearby your house?
Well, there was this Estrella market, and I think that's where that little area is, just west, down there at the corner. And there were a bunch of small homes there, and those people worked on the farm. They were mostly Latinos, and most of them did farm work. Mm-hmm. But no, we never went there, but it was there in case we ever needed a bottle of milk or anything like that. But we usually just went all the way to town. Mm-hmm. But and traded at Bash's. It seems to me there was another grocery store there, but I didn't go there. And I don't remember.
Well, that was the Hightown, I think they're calling it Hightown. That's the area that you're talking about where the little houses were?
Yes, I think that's it. But we just never had a name for it.
Yeah.
But the Estrella Market was there.
Okay.
And I think there's still family members that live there. Yeah.
Okay. Did you ever go to the Kyrene area at all?
No. No, we had a farm up there. But no.
Mm-mm. Where was your farm at?
It was on Baseline. You know where the railroad tracks go across Baseline? It was just east of the railroad tracks. And I think we had 360 acres there or more. Anyway, had a farm there. Mm-hmm. But we never lived there or anything. There was a house on there, but it was a real old house. And the people that we bought it from, a man and his sister lived there alone. And they had been born there. That's how old the house was. And it isn't there any longer because when we sold the land, the developer tore it down. But and I don't even remember their name. But that's the only connection to Kyrene that we have.
And you mentioned that your family owns some other farms in the area?
Well, that's the farm that I'm talking about.
Did you own any other farms besides the one in Kyrene?
Oh, yes, we owned lots of farms, but nothing else. Well, we owned a farm down in what's Ocotillo now. We had farmland down there, mm-hmm. and we had farmland up across from Dobson Road up near Baseline that has developed. Everything's developed. It's not farms anymore.
So did you start to acquire that farmland? Did you acquire that after you moved out of the Price House, or was it before?
Some of it was owned by Jim's family, and some of it we bought, and it's mixed up. Mm-hmm. Okay. He would remember which was which better than I do. We were married when we got the farm on Baseline in Kyrene, but the rest of the farmland I think is owned by his family.
Mm-hmm. Well, a lot of farmland's gone now. That's for sure.
Oh, it's unbelievable. Mm-hmm. It really is. Yeah. I wish we had pictures of those places too, because they all had typical farmhouses on them. You know, big two-story frame houses and. Mm-hmm. A lot of charm, but they weren't elegant or fancy, but they were nice, really nice houses.
Okay. All right. Let's see. Maybe talk about going to downtown Chandler. You mentioned some of the businesses that were down there. Why would you typically go to Chandler, like to downtown Chandler?
Oh, well, I'd go to Chandler for groceries, primarily, and to the drugstore for pharmacy things, and I think there was a 5 and 10 there, too. And then Stapley's, you know, it was like a hardware store. You'd get odds and ends there, and didn't go there very often. But when you needed something, that was the place to go. And that was pretty much it. Mm-hmm.
Did you go to the hotel for events?
Well, the hotel. There was a lady who had a knit shop in the hotel. And she and her husband had lived in Chandler for years. And she had opened up this knit shop because she loved to knit and she was older. She wanted something to do. And I decided I was going to learn how to knit. So I went and would go in there, and she would give me lessons and all of that. And she was, everybody knew her. Nice, nice lady. And so it was social, too. We would go and sit and visit with her, and people would come in and sit and visit. And but that was the only shop I went into there. And they'd have balls there. You know, the Chandler Service Club ball was there every year, and we'd attend that. And but otherwise, no, we didn't utilize it. We didn't use it otherwise.
Okay. Mostly people from out of town, mm-hmm. probably.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And they didn't encourage people to come in and use the facilities. They really didn't. Mm-hmm. You know how, like here, the Phoenician wants you to come and use, yeah. eat their food, and all the hotels do. Mm-hmm. And they have nice restaurants and want you, outsiders to come in. But the San Marcos was pretty much to themselves.
Mm. Yeah, that's interesting, because it is now, it seems like, in contemporary times that the hotels kind of encourage the locals to come and uh-huh. use the hotel, you know, spend the night for a getaway. Or,
sure.
And they even have the, some of them have those big water parks, and they say bring the kids during the summer.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's interesting how that's changed.
Uh-huh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I'm kind of curious about, if you remember the last time that we talked, you talked about the time that you took the Pullman car.
The time that what?
That you took the Pullman car to California.
Oh.
Can you tell me that story again? That was really interesting.
Oh, that was fun. this man had got, oh, what was the man? Mr. Hannah had this private car. And so this man that knew him and lived in Chandler asked him if it was ever available. And he said, well, what do you want it for? And he said, well, we thought it might be fun to get a group together and have a rent a car, not necessarily his, but to rent a Pullman car and go over to L.A. for a football game weekend and see a college football game on Saturday and a pro game on Sunday. And he said, would that be feasible? And evidently Mr. Hannah said, sure, he said, you can have my car. And so we took him up on it, and they brought his car down here to Phoenix. And we all got on it in Phoenix and in the evening. And they had it hooked up next to the club car. And so we put our luggage up and went to the club car. We all met there and had a party, and partied until it was time to go to bed. And by that time, the train was moving. They'd hitched us up to the train, and it was passing through, and it was moving. And we woke up in Alhambra, California. That's where they took our car off. I guess that's where he kept his car, railroad car. And they had a bus met us there. This was in the morning, and took us into town to the Biltmore Hotel, and we checked in there, and then the bus took us to the football game. I think, I don't remember who we saw, whether it was UCLA or USC, and then back to the hotel, and we had a dinner party there that evening, and it was fun. And then the next day we went to the pro game, and after that was over with, they picked us up in our luggage at the hotel and took us back out to the railroad car in Alhambra. We got on it, and once again, we were hooked up to the club car. And so we started partying, and we woke up in Phoenix, and they took our car off the train in Phoenix. And it was fun. It really was. We had a wonderful time. It was a good group, and small but good. You know, mm-hmm. you couldn't get too many people right. on a private railroad car. But it was great fun. Yeah. I enjoyed it very much. That was my first introduction to smog. We used to go to California all the time, and it was so pretty and everything. And I'll never forget that weekend. We go out to the stadium, and all the smog is in the air, and you find you're tearing, and you just can't keep the water out of your eyes. And it just was unbelievable. I couldn't believe that it could be like that. I'd heard about it, and I'd been there, but not to sit in it for, 4 hours for a football game. And it just, it was unbelievable. But no, it was fun.
So did you do that when you were living here?
No, that was when we were living over there.
Okay. All right.
One time. One time was when we were living here.
Oh, okay. Now, did you travel to, other downtowns like Mesa or Phoenix to do anything? Did you travel, to the Mesa downtown or Phoenix downtown to shop or do any of those kind of things?
When I lived out there, I would do my department store shopping in Phoenix, yes. I would come up to Phoenix to do that. Because mm-hmm. They didn't have much to offer down there. And I was used to the stores in Phoenix. So I would use them.
What about going to see a movie or anything like that?
Oh, well, they had one theater in Chandler. And they didn't always have the first runs, but Mesa did. So our little group would go to Mesa and have dinner and go to the movie up there. And that was usually where we went. It was easier to go there than to come to Phoenix. They always got the same movies. So we did that.
What was the movie theater in Mesa?
I don't remember the name.
I know there was one called the Nile that was pretty popular.
Oh, that was a long time ago. Yeah. This one was built after that. I mean, the Nile was still operating, but this was built after that. It was new. And it was one of... who had all the theaters then? Harry Nace was one of them. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if it's his theater or not. But,
yeah, he had quite a few. And then once they started doing the drive-ins, and he had a whole bunch of drive-ins as well.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Did your family attend church anywhere while you were living in the Price House? In that area?
No. What?
Did your family attend church anywhere when you were living in the area?
No. I'm a Catholic and Jim isn't. And I would go into St. Mary's, but not as regular as I usually do. Mm-hmm. And being we live far out and he wasn't, I didn't go as often as I do normally.
Mm-hmm. You're talking about the St. Mary's in Phoenix? Is that the one you're talking about,
St. Mary's? No, I'm talking about St. Mary's in Chandler.
Oh, in Chandler.
Uh-huh.
Because okay. There's a St. Mary's in Phoenix.
So that's a biggie, yeah.
A big church there.
Uh-huh. Yeah. That's a lovely old church.
Yeah. So when did you end up moving from the Price House?
When?
Yeah, when?
In 1950.
And what brought about the decision to move?
Well, Mr. Price wanted to buy our land, and the price was right, and so we sold it. And with Jim having spent so many years up here and having friends up here, and having a child at that point, we thought, well, that's the place to move. So that was the decision. As long as we were going to move, we moved to Phoenix. And so that's what we did.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you moved, Jim said that you moved to the Central and Glendale, mm-hmm. in that area.
Mm-hmm.
This is just kind of a curiosity question. Did you, when you moved to the new house, did you incorporate anything into the new house that you liked from your old house?
Well, the house was already built when we bought it. It was a spec house. And so we didn't have much to say about the construction of it. But we liked the layout and everything. But yes, we took our furniture, lots of furniture, like I told you, the dining room set and our bedroom set, mm-hmm. and a sofa and stuff like that. Well, I think we took both sofas because we had sofas in our den and in the living room. And so that sort of thing. But that was pretty much it.
Okay. Yeah, I wasn't sure if you when you moved there you had the house built or if it was something else.
No, it was already built. They were finishing up when we saw it and decided that was the one we wanted.
Okay.
And we loved the location. I don't know if you're familiar with Wilder Road or not, but at that time we had friends that lived on Wilder Road and it was one of the prettiest streets in Phoenix. And of course this was way out We'd always loved North Central, the drive up North Central. The trees were just so glorious then, and the bridle path and everything. And it was just, we had, the Brophys lived up on North Central. And they had a big family, and they had children our age. And they would have a big party every year at Christmas time. And we'd go to, and it was rural. They had horses and stables and everything. The house is still there. And they owned all the land around it, which is all developed now. And it was such a pretty drive. We just loved it. And then some other friends of ours lived on Wilder Road, which is just a block long. And it's off of Glendale. And there's nice, comfortable homes there. And it's quiet. And it was all citrus groves from Missouri on. It was all citrus groves, and it was just beautiful. Palmer's, Dr. Palmer, they had the house on Bethany Home Road in Central, and it's still there, mm-hmm. and it sits back, and just everything was so pretty, and they were starting to develop housing in there, and they, our lot, we had an acre and a half, or 2 acres, something like that. We had a huge, all the lots were huge, and it had been a piece of 5 acres. The builder had bought the whole 5 acres, and he built, I guess we had 2.5 acres because he only built 2 houses on it. And that's the way it was. It was just, it was rural in a city way, you know what I mean? And it was just really, really nice. And so this house was almost finished being built, and we, the builder had a good reputation. And so that's what we bought, but no, it was it suited us just fine, mm-hmm. and we, like I say, we took some furniture, but otherwise, no.
When did you move here to this house?
We moved to this house in 1971. Okay. Doesn't seem possible. We've been here that long, but
okay. All right. This is just the last question. Why do you think that the history of the Price House is important?
Well, I think it's important because it was one of the better built houses, farmhouses, in the area. And it was unique in the fact that it was built like that. I mean, your typical, like I say, typical farmhouses were charming, believe me. And they were older, and they were all frame and two-story and traditional, you know, like you'd expect. And this was different, completely different. It was so southwestern, a combination of Mexican and Indian, and it just... the people that built it wanted it that way because this was a second home or a third home. And they wanted the atmosphere of the location, and they brought out the southwestern atmosphere in it. And I think that that was part of its charm, mm-hmm. along with being the setting. The setting at that time was magnificent. But the fact that it was unique, very unique. It was funny going out there that day to meet you all. We thought we knew the way. And with them building that freeway, it threw us off, and we couldn't find how to get there. And so we drove around, and finally they were working on Chandler Boulevard, and they were, had a policeman out there directing traffic because they were there was a dumpster dumping asphalt, fresh asphalt on it and everything. And I saw him, and I told Jim, I said, I'm going to find a place to park, and I'm going to go ask him how to get to that house. So I did. I had to go out of my way, and I got out of the car and walked over to him, and I told him what I was looking for. And he said, oh, you mean that old house over there? I said, yes. And he showed me how to get there, what street to go on, and all of that. But I got tickled. I mean, even he knew it was there, and he knew it was old. And... so it really stood out for a long time before they put in the mall. Mm-hmm. And I think that it was the appearance of it and the fact that it sat in the middle of all that farmland. It was and the eucalyptus trees. It was just, unique.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any, like a favorite memory or something that really stands out from the time that you lived in the house?
Well, there's a mix of special friends that came out and would stay with us, and watching our little boy grow up and taking his first steps there and all that sort of thing. And one day he was we were potty training him and had him on the potty, and he got rambunctious and he fell out and he hit his tooth on the tile floor and chipped it and broke it. And we had to find the dentist. It was Sunday, of course. We had to find the dentist, get him out of his home. He met us at the dental office and took care of it and this and that and the other. But things like that. Him spending his first few years. It was funny that he came out with us to see the house. That was the first time he'd ever seen the inside of it, because he didn't remember. He was 2 years old when we moved away, and so he didn't remember it at all. And we had never gone back. Never. Mrs. Price had asked us if we'd like. No, we didn't want to go back. It wouldn't be the same. Yeah. In fact, I was kind of reluctant to go out and see it this time, except I thought, no, you've got to. You really do. And he was very curious. He was glad he got to see the inside of it, because he'd heard us talk about it so much.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm really happy that you came out to see it too.
Yes.
Because you'll get to see kind of the before.
Mm-hmm.
And then once they do all the renovation with the architect.
Yes, I'm anxious to see what all you do. And you just don't know how good it made us feel that they wanted to do something with it. You know, usually something that old, you just think, well, let's just tear it down and start off new or forget about it. But for them to say that it was constructed well enough to do something with it, it made you feel good. And so, yes, I want to see it when you all get through with it. Definitely.
Me too.
Put us on your list to notify.
Yeah, we'll definitely.
Okay, very good.
Okay. All right.
Perfect.
In the late 40s, early 50s, any photographs like that?
We really don't. We just didn't bother to take pictures. We just weren't a camera loving family, and his brother was, but he's since died, and he had those, but no, we never took pictures.
Do you have any pictures of you when you were younger, before you got married, when you were in high school?
I'm going to see them.
Maybe a graduation picture or something.
Pardon?
Maybe a graduation picture from high school.
Oh, dear. I have no idea where that would be. I might have just dumped them when my parents moved. Mother kept all that sort of thing. And when they moved to a retirement home, and when they did, I went through their stuff. And I dumped a whole bunch of stuff.
Okay.
I thought, we don't need that. You know how you do.
Mm-hmm.
And Mother kept everything. So after a while, you think, no, we don't need that. And yet I've accumulated a lot of stuff since then. But I got, if I had 60s.
We have Chandler Boulevard here.